everybody, it's Richard again here from Electric Classic Cars, and today's video is very cold. It's sub-zero, or just about got above freezing now, but it's been sub-zero all week, down to about minus 14, and as Tim would say, it's taters. So I thought, what better opportunity to do an episode on what it's like to drive and own an electric vehicle in the winter. Is it as bad as all those people say out there, or are there some advantages too? So on that note, let's get into it. Right, we've come inside now because it's freezing out there. Not much better inside, but it's a little bit warmer. So what we're going to talk about, as I say, is advantages and disadvantages of owning and driving an electric vehicle in winter. Because if you believe some of the news stories that I've read over the years and some videos on YouTube, you'd think that driving an electric vehicle is all about disadvantages in the winter and the range is halved in the winter, etc., etc. Now, having driven and owned electric vehicles now for 7 years, I can say most of that is absolute BS. There is loads of advantages of owning and driving an electric vehicle in the winter. And yes, there are a few disadvantages, like the range does reduce, but it's nowhere near what you normally see and read in newspapers, let's say. So let's get into the advantages first. Now, one advantage, which I think is my wife's favourite advantage of owning an electric car in the winter, is preheating the cabin. So imagine it, you're waking up, you're coming for your breakfast downstairs, you're looking out the window going, oh, that looks grim out there, there's snow on the ground. And then you remember. You open up the app for your car and you tap a button and you preheat the cabin. So in a few minutes' time, the cabin is as toasty as the house, usually more toasty, and all the heated seats are on as well. So that's a feature my wife loves. Now, yes, you can do that with a petrol diesel car, but you literally have to go outside in your slippers, start the engine of the car, leave the engine running, which, you know, if you do that in a city, you know, that's a car with a key in running outside. Somebody can just nick it and drive away. So that's a feature that my wife particularly loves. Now, it's not a feature we have on the classic converted cars yet, but it's definitely a feature we're working on. Now, advantage number two, which is more relevant for me, because I don't have that lovely feature that my wife likes, which is the preheating. I have to actually get into the car and turn the heating on and instant heat, literally. Now that's something that it's more like a hand dryer in a washroom. The fan comes on, heating element comes on, and within about a second or two, bang, heat. Now in a petrol or diesel car, you'll be a good few minutes, if not 10 minutes into your journey before you start getting any useful heat out of the actual engine, because the heat that comes from an engine is waste heat, and obviously that's not going to be hot until the engine gets hot. So that's advantage number two. Now, another advantage of driving an electric car in the winter on slippery conditions like ice and snow is traction control, because an electric motor is directly connected via this gear set here to the wheels, and it's controlling the motor and therefore the wheels thousands of times a second. Whereas a petrol or diesel, the best you can hope for with traction control with that is maybe a couple of times a second. It's like monitoring for any slip. So we found that traction control on electric vehicles is a lot better and a lot smoother than a petrol and diesel car. So there you go, electric motor is definitely a better option when you're controlling a car in slippery conditions. Now we're on to the subject of controlling a car in winter conditions and the handling of a car in slippery conditions. When you look at a modern EV, the battery pack is usually underneath you here, and that's the perfect place you want the weight to be. The center of gravity is nice and low and it's central to the car. So as far as handling is concerned, you'll struggle to beat an electric vehicle, which is really important when it's in slippery conditions in the winter. So that's a huge advantage of an electric car in winter conditions. Obviously, we can't do that with electric converted classic cars because there's simply nowhere to put the batteries underneath the floor pan. So what we do there, we take that big heavy lump that's normally in the front and we split the weight with two battery packs, front and rear, which optimises the weight distribution of the car, and again, usually ends up improving the handling of the car. Now, I'm progressively getting warmer because I've moved into the offices now, so I'm starting to warm up a bit. So that was all the advantages that I could think of anyway. Question to all you electric car owners out there. Have I missed some advantages? I'm sure I probably have. So comments below.
what other advantages of having an electric car in the winter have I missed? But it's time to talk about disadvantages, and I can really only think of one, if I'm honest, which is the range is reduced in an electric car during the winter months. So why is that? And you know, a lot of people out there that don't own electric cars have either seen headlines of like electric cars are rubbish in the winter because it reduces the range by 50%, or they have the experience with their phone and think, oh, in the winter months or when I go skiing, you know, my phone dies, you know, within a few minutes. Why is that? So let's get into the technicalities of that before I go into some number crunching. So why is a battery not so great when it's cold? Well, batteries are a little bit like humans. There is a Goldilocks zone where they like to be as far as temperature is concerned. And it's above zero and it's below 50 degrees. And to be honest, it's really nice and comfortable, just like humans when it's above 10 degrees and below 40 degrees. That's kind of where you want to keep a battery. So whenever it's in, you know, near zero or certainly sub-zero temperatures, a battery doesn't work very efficiently, let's say. And, you know, experience of me and Tim going skiing is if you do have a phone when you go skiing, put it on your inside pocket, not your outside pocket, because it'll last most of the day then rather than a few hours. And that's because you're warming it up. Now, the same happens with an electric car. Now, some cars have preconditioning or preheating of the battery, which that helps because essentially on a cold day, just like you're preheating the cabin, you can preheat the battery to get it up to temperature before you start your journey. Obviously, that takes a little bit of energy out of the battery. And this is where the reduction in range comes in, because there's two things that happen with reduction of range, or two reasons. Number one is the battery efficiency isn't as good when it's really cold. And number two, you're heating things up. You're either heating up the occupants or the battery, or both in some instances. So thermal management of the battery is definitely going to affect your range as well as the temperature of the battery itself. So if you want a super efficient electric car as far as, you know, reducing the effect of the temperatures on the range, get an electric car that has a heat pump, because that's an efficient way to not only heat up the battery but also the people in the cabin. And get one that you can do preconditioning of the battery, as in preconditioning the temperature of the battery. So those are two features I would ask when you're buying a new electric car: is does it have a heat pump, and can you preheat the battery in cold weather? Because that has a definite positive effect, or it certainly reduces the negative effect of the reduction in range in the winter. But what about those, you know, 50% reduction headline figures that you see in newspapers and things like that? Is it really true? Well, no, quite frankly. And I challenge anybody out there to prove me wrong, because I've been driving electric cars through the winter now for 7 winters, and I can't get anywhere near 40%, 50% reduction in range. And here's why I think that is, because journalists out there, and certainly some YouTube stars out there, or influencers, let's call them, isn't it, Tim? They like to sensationalise things to get the views, which, you know, I don't do. I'm a purely engineer, facts and figures guy. And what they're doing is they're taking the WLTP range, if you like, which is a little bit like, you know, your brochure range or miles per gallon for a car, let's say. And then they do a journey in sub-zero temperatures, and then they come back and go, oh, my range was nowhere near that. Well, that's your problem, because I'm sure if you drove that car in the summer and compared it to the WLTP figures, you wouldn't be anywhere close either. Because, you know, if you buy a new car that's, say, 50 miles per gallon in the brochure, you drive it and tell me if you get 50 miles per gallon. You don't. So the first problem that most people are doing there is they're comparing it to brochure figures, if you like, which aren't really real world figures in the first instance. So what I've done a little bit of research. It's not just from my experience. I've done some research, and certainly there's some videos out there. I'll put a few links to those videos in the description. And I've looked at what is the real world range of certain cars versus the real world range in summer to winter. And I've actually taken range out, because range is, you know, something that's a little bit difficult sometimes to calculate for people. So I've looked at the efficiency, which is a little bit like miles per gallon. So what I've got here is the miles per kilowatt hour for a number of cars, and I've kind of like truncated it down to six cars because there was loads that we looked at, but just six cars, common electric cars, new cars obviously out there, and we looked at what was the miles per kilowatt hour in the summer, and then what was the miles per kilowatt hour for those same cars under the same conditions and the same people doing the tests in the winter. And this is what we found. So for instance, a Tesla Model 3, which is a very efficient electric car because it's got heat pumps, it's got preheating and preconditioning of the battery, etc. So that was getting 4.2 miles per kilowatt hour in the test that I was looking at. In the winter, it was getting 3.7. So that's a reduction of 12%. So in the winter, you got 12% less range, if you like, and less efficiency in the winter compared to the summer months. And most of these are in kind of like, you know, typical British temperatures. So you're talking about 20 odd degrees. Actually, that's a pretty hot day in the summer, isn't it, in the UK? But we're talking about summer temperatures in the UK and winter temperatures, which is just above, let's say, freezing. So obviously in Canada, when you get down to minus 40 and things like that, Celsius I'm talking about, these figures can go up, but not as much as people think. And I'll put another link below in the description to watch a guy that did some range tests in Canada, for instance, in those type of temperatures. So this is what we found for a typical European, British summer versus winter driving. There was 12%, 40, I think the worst was 19%, which is a Skoda Enyaq, probably again because it didn't have certain features like battery preheat and heat pumps. But I would say the average reduction in range is probably what I would say somewhere between, say, 16, 17, let's say 17% reduction in range is the average there. So it's certainly not as bad as 50% or 40% that people might think. And when you're also reading some of these news stories about driving an electric car in the winter, and you say, what would happen if you're stuck in snow on the M25 for a few hours and the heating goes? Well, let's talk about that, because how much energy does the heater really take? So back on with the jacket and out into the workshop. Now, we're back out in the cold again, and regarding range, I mean, people always go, you know, on about that range reduction in winter, but 99% of my journeys, I never really bother about like the maximum range my vehicle is doing, because I'm either driving to work, I'm driving to the shops, or I'm doing certainly journeys below, let's say, 200 miles. So it's very rare that actually, you know, that range reduction, I even notice it. In fact, I don't notice it, quite frankly, if I'm honest. In 7 years, I don't really notice the range reduction. But what I wanted to show you now is what those parasitic loads are in the vehicle. Because what I have here, I have a battery heater. So this is a battery heater. So this is what's preheating right now in this vehicle, the battery pack. And essentially all it is you've got your coolant coming in here, and there's an element in here that the coolant passes over, and then that nice warm coolant goes out then to the battery pack and warms that battery pack up. So whenever I do preheating in my vehicle, that's essentially what we're doing, is just turning on a heating element, if you like, this heating up the coolant that then heats up the battery. So this is in my vehicle now, and if you actually look down at the temperatures down here, because I've actually had it on for a bit now, it should be around about 20 degrees, because that's what I like to get the optimum performance out of my battery packs, even though it's about, I would say, just above freezing outside. That's now heating up to about 20 degrees Celsius. So the other thing that takes a bit of energy out of the battery pack in winter, obviously, is heating up the participants in the vehicle, heating up the passengers in the vehicle, is something like this. So this essentially is a PTC heating element. So as I mentioned before, it's kind of like a typical element you'd have in, say, a hairdryer or a hand dryer in a washroom. That element heats up, you pass air over that through there, and out comes warm air. So that's a PTC heater. They're not as efficient, let's say, as heat pumps, which are used primarily on most modern EVs now. And that's something we're going to be testing and looking into in 2023, is fitting heat pumps to our conversions to make them even more efficient. So those are the two things that are parasitic loads, if you like, that take energy out of the car when it's going. But how much energy? So at the moment, I've got that preheater on. In fact, I can see now it's finished. So it's up to temperature. So if I turn the heating on, and bear in mind, I've got a PTC heater, which is quite inefficient. I'm going to turn it on, and then we'll see how many kilowatts it's taking. There you go. Now, usually with resistant-based heaters, there's an inrush of current, so the amps will go, whoa, and then it'll come down and essentially maintain that temperature. So at the moment, we're taking, can't read it upside down, about 3.5 kilowatts, and I reckon about half of that kilowatt is just keeping the car alive, so it's pumps, DC converters, things like that. So I'd say it's around about 3 kilowatts that heater is now taking out of the battery pack. Now, it might sound a lot, but bear in mind that motor in the back is a 450 kilowatt motor. Okay, that's if you've got your foot flat to the floor. So I would say it's probably around about, if I had that heater on full, and bear in mind you'd be melting within minutes if I did. If I had that on full, I reckon that's probably around about 8% of the energy coming out of the battery is going to the heater, and the other 92% is going to the motor to drive you along at around about, say, 55, 60 miles an hour. So that's the proportion that the heater takes compared to the motor. The motor takes huge amounts of energy. The heater takes a little bit of energy. And certainly when you get up to temperature, and you'll get up to temperature so quickly, that will go down. And if not, you'll actually turn it off. So the heater doesn't take as much as people think. So when people are thinking, oh, it's, you know, huge energy reductions or huge range reductions in the winter, it's not the heater that's doing that. It's usually the inefficiency of the battery when it's cold. So, but it all adds up. The heater, the heater for the cabin, the heater for the battery pack, and the inefficiencies. And that's where that average 17% reduction in range between summer and winter comes from. So there you go. Hopefully that's answered most of your questions. Knowing me, it's probably, you know, started more arguments and more debate and more questions, if nothing else. But electric car owners out there, questions or comments below. What advantages and disadvantages have I missed out? Because I've probably missed out loads. So let's have a debate on this subject down in the comments, and we'll have a chat there. And hopefully you enjoyed this video, and we'll see you on the next one.